Shed Floor Replacement Part 2. In the last video, Shed Floor Replacement Part 1, I removed the old double-laid plywood flooring. This task was made considerably more difficult because I had to cut and chop along the edges of the walls to remove the subflooring. Since the walls, in common practice, were placed directly over the subflooring. Lesson number one. If you build a shed or any structure, don't put the walls atop the subflooring, as the subflooring may need replacing in the future, and removal will be much easier if you don't have to cut along the length of walls to remove the subflooring. Always try to think of the next guy or gal 50 years from now. Here's the shed, or actually my sister's playhouse my father built over 50 years ago. And here's the damaged wall with the aluminum siding removed. And here's how the wall looked from the inside. Note the hole, which was made by raccoons. Lesson number two. When rehabilitating a shed or any structure, replace old knowledge with new. But always keep the original thing alive. Rebuild, but don't destroy. Have respect for the work and materials that have gone before. In essence, preserve. Here's how the playhouse looked after taking away the rotted wall and all the inside paneling and raccoon nesting debris. Next, I removed the plywood subflooring, and here are some of the tools I used.
Get the idea.
With the plywood subfloor removed, I turned my attention to the foundation and old floor joists. The structure was set up on blocks on the four corners and were still stable. The joists were rotted on the ends where they met the rotted wall area. Thus I began by sistering or attaching pressure-treated 2x4s and 4x4s to the old floor joists. As I reinforced the old joists with new wood, I also placed pieces of broken concrete, concrete patio blocks and scrap 4x4s and pieces of old roofing slate underneath the joists, thereby creating a sturdy foundation under the entire joist system, whereby there would be no floating or suspended joists, and an elimination of any sagging or sponginess which tends to occur over time. In short, I wanted the new floor to be stiff and sturdy for a long time. Pieces of old slate roofing were used as wedges to tighten the foundation under the joists. Also, I dug down and removed dirt so that there was about 9 inches to 12 inches between the joists and the ground. This allows for airflow, which helps keep the joists dry and moisture-free thereby. Take your time. You will not see that foundation for another 50 years or more. Here's a section of the floor where pressure-treated 4x4s were sistered or attached to the original 2x4s.
Yeah, part of the beefing up process, I ran another 4x4 along the one that was originally here, and I kneeled it in, and it's also up on the patio blocks. And this one I actually had to wedge it with had to hit it in with a sledgehammer. As you can see how tight it is, and that'll really beef this up. There it is. Not bad. That's up against the block in the back. I actually had to use a sledgehammer. That really tightens things. This old playhouse. So start, it'll get stronger and stronger. This is called beefing up the floor. I don't like that spongy, mushy feeling you get when you walk over, you know, wood that is suspended like that. So I beat it up, put a little foundation in.
With the joists and foundation fortified to the point of extreme, I next turn my attention to insulating the bays between the floor joists. This was, of course, meant to be a playhouse, not a shed, so insulating it seemed warranted. The bays between the floor joists were of different sizes, so I cut the insulation accordingly and used some double-sided aluminum tar paper for the edges. Also, strips of duct tape were run along the edges of joists and insulation to close any gaps. Cold air kills, so a little insulation never hurts, especially in the long run. Lesson number 3. Plywood subflooring for outdoor structures or sheds should be moisture-proofed on the side that faces the ground. 3 coats of an exterior paint, latex or oil, will provide an adequate moisture barrier and greatly extend the life of the subfloor. The top side would benefit from a simple coat of clear coating sealer or shellac for protection and looks. And here next is the final process, ending with the new plywood subfloor. Here is the floor plate of the new wall. Note, not built upon the subfloor. Think ahead.